Why? Welcome back to Resistance at the Threshold. This is session 6 entitled Dead Messengers. Last session, the group started the Day of Dan, hosting the abbess from Ermorag Monastery. In the start of the day, Morax was given the privilege of hosting a handful of knights of Ermorag, and also the captain of the knights, one Romund, the non-biological father of one Evangeline Woven. I looked up a pronunciation guide. Thank you. They have been walking around and maintaining security, which tip top, no problems. The grand hall beneath the keep has served as the hosting location. Summer and other worshippers of Alwain performed the morning ritual and then headed over. It was Dahabe's purpose to serve as host for the time that Evangeline was absent during that process. It was very clearly stated by the abbess that she believes that the forces of the Denisotvin people will be inclined to cause issue to the towns around Ermorag, and she is prepared to stand against them. To a lot of people in the audience, it sounded very much like she was basically banging the drums for conflict. Like she was very much prepared for not good things to happen. That said, conversations abound, dialogues back and forth. We ended on a narrative point, but we're going to do a lead up to that narrative point, and we are going to then make it to that narrative point. So Morax, Romund is very quiet, very astute. During your process of kind of wandering about the guard, maintaining a vigil, he says little to nothing. But you can see in his eyes and also in his actions that he is taking note of everything and is very clearly consuming this information, kind of holding it in his head. He's very open to any dialogue or discourse that you would put forward, but he doesn't speak until he's spoken to, as he is currently in the effectively the subordinate position in this discourse. Oh no, why? Windows just did like 2 alert beeps in my ear.
Oh, no.
And probably everyone watching's ears too. I'm so sorry. Anywho, do you have anything that you'd like to discuss with Romund, the captain of the Ermorag Knights?
I feel like more I'd just be walking through in almost the same kind of situation. I don't really know him super well, so I'm taking him around the town, trying to take care of official business and just attempting to make small talk. Like, oh, if you want to get lunch somewhere while you're here, this place here has some of the best meat pies in town.
He pats his bag and says, I have brought easy-to-consume food for the walking discourse. If it is your typical process to stop and eat during your cycle, absolutely do not be bothered by me. I will probably try and take up with one of your lieutenants in the process, if that is fine.
Yeah, that's not a problem. Again, you gotta keep it real official when you're here with... what's her name?
So, just a heads up, if you ever have this issue, inside of handouts, there is a folder called Dramatis Personae, and if you see, there's also a folder under that called Ermorag, and that'll have the names of
Thank you.
All the folks you're looking for. The name you're looking for is Velandrin
Yes.
Arachnius
Yes.
or Abbess Arachnius.
When you're here with the Abbess, gotta keep it all professional.
I always try to maintain a high level of professionalism. My reputation was soured due to a lack of such professionalism.
Course, but I'm always one of the mind that people can change, so I'm sure that in your years since that whole situation, you've undeniably grown as a person, and I trust you as much as I trust one of my best friends here.
I appreciate that, but I think the matter is slightly skewed. I didn't change from then. I'm simply returning to form. I changed that day. I allowed pettiness to consume me. I allowed emotion to swell within me. I allowed myself to be swayed by passion rather than rationality.
Everybody makes mistakes every now and then. I know better than a lot of people. Think what matters is you've moved on, but you didn't forget it.
Absolutely. The day goes by pretty uneventfully, rather the morning. There's a point where you do see that the matriarch is moving from the temple to the keep, and there is a moment where you think to yourself, well, maybe I should attend. You then realize the nature of that, and instead kind of quickly gesture and move through Calling Stone, some of your individuals to kind of move with the lady to the keep. Her passage is safe without issue, but this kind of leads you away from the heart of town. There's a time where you kind of cycle out to the western most gate, the Blue Dog Gate, and then kind of make your way back across the Sunset Bridge towards the marketplace and courtyard. And during this time, it's basically shown that everywhere here is well guarded, well defended. All of your guard are at full attention, and there does not appear to be any reports of anything ill toward on the outside of the town or within. Then you and the honored guest, Captain of the Knights, walk towards the mayor's office. Now, it hasn't been used in a long time, but just outside of the mayor's office is a gallows. And again, the last time these have been used, probably well before your time as Captain of the Guard. You've never had to string anyone up or perform any sort of capital punishment. However, despite that, as you move towards those gallows and can see that there's something amiss, you notice that there are two dead bodies hanging from the gallows. Roman
Is
looks.
anybody around?
It's just you and
Besides
Roman.
us.
And Roman kind of looks at you, because you, I'm assuming, are showing some emotional sign, right?
As soon as I see that, I'm just like, by the gods, what happened here?
He looks around. Doesn't look like there's anyone that I can see who has remained around this. This is not your doing or the town's doing.
No, we haven't had to use these since before my time as captain. I couldn't tell you when last time we there was a hanging out here.
Your predecessor was a bit more tight with the noose.
So I've heard that's another time. That's another time.
Well,
I call for I yell out for some more guards to come over and give me a hand.
okay. Yeah, they kind of come around from kind of up top near the Lore Master's Tower. You can see Roman kind of like holding his chin. Roman has not been drawn yet. Again, I've been kind of swamped with a lot of stupid stuff, but I just want to make sure you understand what is planned for Roman in the drawing. Roman is not a upturned Kennelborn. He is a lupine Kennelborn, so he has a bit more of a wolf-like look to him. And yes, unfortunately, that means you are kind of standing next to like a furry.
God damn it!
Not really. Not really. He's not a furry.
The furry and the scaly.
Technically.
A fur dream. He is a very dashing-looking kind of wolf-like humanoid with kind of grayish hair all throughout. And he kind of, you know, holds his hand on his chin, strokes it, letting his, you know, eyes kind of peruse this. And he looks over to you and he says, "Do you know who these people are?"
Do I recognize them?
They are not local. They are wearing garb that is very strange to you. You can make a history check to see if you can discern the kind of outfits that they're wearing. Sufficient. 13. So they are wearing Denisatvin garb. They appear to be what are known as cliff jumpers, which are riders who ride on creatures known as Blusa, large flea creatures. You remember hearing a report that two Blusa were seen at Iron Shoe Stables yesterday. These individuals must have been their riders, but as to who has strung them up, you are unsure.
No, they're not from around here.
Kind of scratching his chin. I don't want to tamper with them, but it does look like there's something strapped to that man's belt. And yeah. You can see there appears to be a kind of parchment in his belt.
It signals to some others, like, "Help me get these two down."
Yeah, the guard kind of quickly rush over to you and assist you laying out the bodies onto the gallows. He kind of keeps to the ground level. You and the others are kind of up on the gallows, which are a good, 10 feet off the ground, with kind of like a step, but kind of like a very steep step, almost like a ladder that goes up to where you would string someone up. Because, of course, they need room to descend. Once you kind of get up there and bring the bodies down with your associates, it does look like the only thing that's really upon them besides their garb is this scroll, kind of in the belt of one of the two individuals.
What does it say?
You pull it open and it's written in a strange language, that you may not be privy to. It appears to be written in Elvish.
Do not believe I am. Where are you? I'm not.
Yeah, you would see that it's definitely beyond Romand, and you can see that the people who you have kind of gathered here, none of them are Elvish.
I at least would be familiar enough with Elvish to know it's Elvish, right?
Yeah. So, real quick note, there are scripts, like there are like letterings that you would kind of know are what they are. So the common or basic script is off of the Etish alphabet. It's a, you know, entire alphabet. The Elvish language is written in Rolonic, which is very much different, very swirly, very not quite Tolkien, but close enough for you to be able to detect it. And then Draconic, of course, is a bit more kind of like jagged and forced. Okay. And it's the Davokic, I believe, script. Spelling for that, I don't remember. But anyways, this appears to be Elvish. The bodies in question, they do look quite deceased. Do you want to look them over at all? Or is there anything that you want to investigate about the scene here?
I'll give them a quick look over.
Okay. Are you looking for, again, there really doesn't look like there's anything on them, like, item-wise, but are you giving them a look over, like, trying to see, like, if there's anything, what are you looking for particularly?
I'm looking for, like, signs of a struggle. Likely they died by hanging, but, like, there's also a chance that they were killed and then just strung up there.
Okay. So
looking for that. So signs of a struggle and confirmation that the hanging is what killed them.
Two rolls for the kind of search over as to, like, you know, signs of mal, just like a bad, my brain's not remembering what that word is, investigation, and then the second roll will be medicine.
Okay. Investigation.
And
roll.
Medicine. Oof.
Okay. So, as you're kind of looking at the bodies, you do notice that there are scratch marks around the neck and around the wrists. These scratch marks are consistent with, like, bindings, rope, or otherwise. Based on the neck marks, like, of course you'd expect there to be them there, but typically with a hanging, there isn't much kind of, it's kind of sudden, if you get my meaning, it kind of hangs off of your neck, and then when you're dropped, it pops, and then goes tight, so it's kind of just one nice mark. Whereas this, it appears that they have kind of markings that would make you think that there was movement inside of the bindings and inside of the noose. There's also cut marks and also kind of like bits of fabric in their fingernails. The fabric doesn't match the color of anything that's present here. It's kind of a darker color, and the individuals here are kind of wearing a light green color, which is pretty common of the Denisovan people. It definitely looks like they have signs of strangulation, but you really can't tell for sure if that was the cause of death or something that might have been done to them prior, and then they were killed in a more exacting method.
All right. Once I've looked that over, I'll tell some other guards to take them to the morgue, wherever that might be.
Okay. So, a great question that you get to answer. So,
oh, yay.
We have a temple, and the temple typically deals with the healing. Does the Temple of Life also handle the dead? Or is there another place in the city that deals with cadavers?
Well, it's Temple of Life, not the Temple of the Dead.
It's up to you, but also input from others. It doesn't have to be just you making a decision here.
In my experience, one typically leads to the other.
Yeah.
Well,
because Alloyne is life and death. Oh, okay. It's the cycle of life.
Then I see no reason why, like, the temple wouldn't at least have, like, a section that deals with, like, embalming and all that.
Okay. So as the guards kind of get the bodies...
Like, over here.
Get the bodies ready. You see Roman kind of at kind of ground level looking up at you, kind of stroking his chin, and then he kind of says up to you, "Should we inform the Abbess and the Matriarch?"
I'll take care of informing the Abbess. I'll also get my guard to check around, see if anybody saw anything.
I will attend with them then. I assume my presence is not wanted in the keep.
Stop it.
Have your as you wish.
I do not know if you were given specific instruction, but it does feel a bit like the captain of the watch was assigned the duty of ensuring that I didn't get into any trouble.
Why don't you just stay around with me if you don't mind?
Of course.
That would be a yes. Sir.
Is anybody around? I'll get my stone out, and I'm going to contact the matriarch, Evangeline.
Okay. This would probably be not too long after Evangeline, your conversation with the abbess regarding her asking you if you felt you were worthy to deal with the threat of the Denisovans. As you kind of settle down and you look down at the first course of this long kind of day of feasting, you basically settled on the, oh yeah, okay, at least a little bit of, and then ring.
Hello?
My lady, we've got a bit of a situation.
Oh. Cool. How close? The abbess is like right next to me, right?
Yep. She is already starting to eat, yes.
All right, she would just say, one moment. God. Now she's torn, because, like, if she gets up, it's obvious something's happening. But she stays there, the abbess overhears it. And you she's not sure what it is yet.
You could send someone in your stead.
Okay.
Or you can go yourself, it's entirely up to you.
I think she would send... She would want Dahabe with her, and then she would gesture to Mikhail, I think. Is he down? He's down at the tables.
Mikhail is, yeah, he is with the guilds.
Right, but if you gesture for me, I would come up to you.
Yeah, so she would just gesture for him and just be like, the captain wishes a word about a matter.
And I would say, absolutely, my lady. I will handle it and give you a full report. And then I would like,
thank you.
Leave the actual hall and pull out my
as you're trying to leave. Roko reaches out and grabs a hold of your sleeve, yeah. Mikhail, and says, "Where are you going?"
Oh, yeah. Just a minute. I have to take an important call, but I will be right back.
All right.
That's Green Bottle, right? You're talking about. Yeah.
And Mikhail, go ahead and make a insight roll.
Uh-oh. See, this is bad. I'm the guy who invites somebody to a dance and then, like, leaves partway through.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. All right, insight. Ooh, I rolled a 17. That's pretty good for me.
So her position throughout the discourse, throughout the kind of just... Petty talking about, you know, what's going on with the abbess's words and the like, has been kind of vaulted in part due to the fact that she's sitting next to you at the table that she's sitting at. So it appears that she's kind of feeling like she's being ditched in this way. But you'd also notice that the others seem to start talking in silent discourse amongst themselves, no matter... regarding the matter, not sure what they're saying, but it does seem that you leaving has caused the other guild masters to kind of take notice. The one exception, because you rolled high, is our good old-fashioned favorite friend, cobbler.
Noldos.
My brain did the thing.
That's right.
He seems to be very... in his cups and focused on, like, he appears to be clearly depressed and trying to work through it.
Right. Makes sense. All right. I need to endeavor to return quickly. And so I will head out.
Okay.
And I'll get my communicator and I'll be like, Sheriff, this is the magnate. The lady has asked me to look into whatever you need to talk to her about and report back to her.
Well, we found some bodies hanging on the gallows.
That's what I would probably do.
It was then he knew he wasn't going back quickly.
Right. All right. Actually... I would say I will be there. Well, like, I will be at the gallows as soon as possible. I just need to leave word and then I'll handle that. So I would hang up. I would go to the mayor,
mm-hmm.
and I would kind of just whisper, like, really quickly what I thought the problem. Oh, actually, I'll just do it. I'll be like, Casey, we have a situation. It appears that there have been some hangings on the gallows.
Sorry, a situation.
Oh God! God damn it,
Casey! I'd be like, Yes, I'm telling you so that you could try to help. If you would, could you help my, to see that my date does not feel too abandoned, and also kind of just keep an eye on all the guests in general, because this is a big situation and we want to kind of keep it quiet. So
yeah, Sven kind of looks at you and says, well, "What about me?"
You know, I'd never leave you for long, darling, but duty calls.
I don't know. That green bottle, she's quite the coy one.
Oh, actually, yeah, I don't want to mislead you. Like, my original intent was for you to stay at the party, but just so that you knew what was going on. But if you would want to come with me, and like, that's fine too. You know, whatever. I'm just trying to handle this. This is very bad that there's been, you know, people hanged during this event, and you know, I just need to go investigate. Whatever you think's best. If you want to come with me, or if you want to stay here, either way.
Casey, you are sitting close to Summer, right?
I think that was the seating.
Yeah. So. It didn't sound like he was being very quiet with his statements regarding there being
not
hangings.
Even remotely. So he would have very, very loudly enough, so like three or four people around him would have heard him say. A situation.
Oh my gosh.
So Summer,
in that case, leans over. Situation.
I would just be like, all right, come on, guys. Let's go quickly. Let's go. We got to get out of here. This is getting out of hand. All right.
As you wish.
So then as we would leave, once we're not around people, I would try to fill them in with what I knew. But I don't really know a whole lot. I just got really briefly what was going
on. As I'm leaving, I say to Aspen, looks like the green bottle's yours to play with, and wink as I like.
You see Aspen kind of go, all of his eyes kind of shut at once. And then you see him kind of open them all up and kind of flick his tongue out and say,
oh no.
I look at Espen and I say, be nice.
I will.
That's all I say.
Be as cordial as ever. And they start to just float over that way. As you three kind of move out of this space, there's definitely a notice. Like, everyone notices.
And of course.
the abbess kind of leans in and says, What was all of that about?
Just having them look into a matter. I'll keep you appraised as soon as I am aware of anything.
Very good. This is quite good, she says, and then the scene cuts. You three are heading out. Summer, as you're kind of moving that way, obviously, like, your eyes would lead you to your temple. It's your place of business. So as you're kind of maneuvering around, heading towards the steps to head down to the mayor's office and then eventually the gallows, you would see that there are a number of guards who are moving with, why is my brain not working?
Stretchers?
That's it. And
see, I know what you're thinking.
They have like some sort of drape over them that would lead you to assume that they are not alive. The two bodies that are being maneuvered towards the temple. Muted.
Ah, you're muted.
Dang it.
It looked like it was going to be great.
Sorry. I'll try it again. Is that the situation?
Unfortunately, yes. Sorry to pull you out of that, but this really needs to be handled. And it looks like it's going to be very difficult.
Well, I guess I have duties to attend to.
Heading to the temple?
Yeah.
Okay.
Good thing I came.
Mikhail and Casey, you head down the steps, passing by the mayor's office. You can see that Moirax and Roman are still kind of standing there at present. They didn't move with the bodies. They kind of remained here. Nothing new has been gleaned, by the way, Chris. You're still just kind of very concentrated on this area and this area specifically. If it was someone that was trying to avoid your sight and avoid your guard sight, they would have had to have come from one of these buildings nearby.
Okay.
That said, Casey and Mikhail arrive. Roman looks to Mikhail. Long time no see, Master Vine.
Yes. I hope your time has been well.
As good as it can be. And how goes the life, the organizer of this place, Master
Busy Fuzzy? As ever. Busy as ever.
And then, oh my gosh. So, like, to me, since I had seen these people, like, is it the people I had seen, like, a day ago? You know what I mean? Are these the people that we had seen?
We saw the mounts.
Saw the mounts. We were right. We didn't see the people even from a distance. Damn it. But I guess what I would say then, I'd be like, do you guys realize, I'm going to state the obvious. I'd be like, do you guys realize that this, somebody's trying to frame us, you know, to kill these people and then, you know, cause a big stink. So I think what we have to do is obviously find out what happened. And then I think we need to just plainly say that we didn't do this because that's our only hope.
Your good captain's vigilance kept us aware of the situation. I assume quite shortly after it unfolded, because there's no one screaming or coming to us to tell us tales as to who did it, I couldn't begin to hypothesize.
Do either of you two happen to know how to read Elvish?
Yes, of course.
We both do.
Casey holds out their hands.
I hand him the scroll. This was attached to the belts of one of them.
Unabashedly opens and starts reading out loud. So whatever it says, everyone gets to hear.
Yep. It says, people of Gateneath. You.
That's us.
And us are intertwined in our fates. This is as much your sin as it is ours. No signature.
Well, that's not very helpful, is it? They didn't even bother to sign the thing.
They said, what was the last part? This is just as much your
sin.
Oh, as sin.
Ours.
I do not agree, I would say.
I'd say it's mostly their sin.
Yes, somebody is trying to cause us to be in open war with the Denistavians, and that is not good for business. Am I right? I'd look over at the mayor.
Depends on the business.
That is true.
Just gonna let it go.
So yeah, we got to get to the bottom of this, and we need to defuse it as much as possible.
You said you saw the mounts. Where was this? Perhaps we could garner more information from saddles, yes, or any other belongings that could be with them. No.
Good point. We saw. Weren't they actually at the stables, or did we see them somewhere else, like outside some building? I thought we saw them at the stables.
Stables. They weren't inside. Yeah. They were outside. But yeah.
All right.
Let's checking in with the stables. That is a good next move while the captain searches the local buildings for any more clues or any individuals who might have seen something.
That is a good possible. Actually, I wouldn't mind inspecting the area right now just to see if I could happen to pick something up. But
I'm happy to investigate the stables on my own.
I mean, I think
this is a
task
I can undertake.
I think so, Mayor.
Excellent.
Little guy.
He charges off. not another word. Smug speed, like, jogs off.
I think set the two bodies over to the temple, so.
Yeah. Oh, okay. They're already set over there.
We need to look at those, and we can pop on over there, check them out.
All right. I'll check the area first, I guess. Just do a quick check of the area, you know, like to see if there's anything that pops out to me that they didn't notice, which I don't think will happen, but.
Mikhail, is Summer inside of the keep? Or is she within the temple? Roman asks.
She was headed to the temple, so I believe that's probably where she'll be.
He looks over to Moirex. I assume that her and hers will be keenly examining the corpses. If you'd like, we can go and attend them, but we can also assist here with Mikhail's investigation.
I think that if she needs information from us, she'll be sure to contact me. She's the best of the best.
More than proven.
I think we'd be best. I think we'd be best to investigate the area. Maybe ask a few people around here, see if they saw anything.
Absolutely. Roman kind of looks to Mikhail. I knew your father better, but you seem to be very astute and inquisitive. I like that.
Thank you. I appreciate the compliments, and I'm hoping that our investigation will lead to something. I think we'll check around this area first and then maybe check the two closest buildings. That does seem to be the most likely, you know, place that they entered from. Actually, Captain, our Sheriff, do you know if these buildings are occupied? Or actually, I should know that, probably.
Yeah, probably. But the nature of these buildings is determinant on kind of how we're going to continue, because a lot of it is unfilled. Some of it is not. So,
but I'm trying to think, what would you put? What would, you know, like what building would be right next to the gallows? You know what I mean? It would have to be something that wouldn't be affected by people being hung, because, you know,
although the DMV.
Yeah.
No.
Yes.
Very,
government building.
Very simply. So this would be the Undertaker. This is the Coffin Maker.
Yes, that would be perfect, actually.
And that would be the building directly behind the gallows.
All right.
I like the DMV better, but...
Well, yeah.
Well, they're actually the same, yeah.
They're the same.
I knew it.
So, yeah, I would just want to check the general area. Like, I don't actually expect to find anything, but, you know, it would just be routine to do that. Like, I could certainly not do it.
So this other building next to it is a bit larger, and I've actually already come to understand what that would be. And
that's pretty big, yeah.
Yeah, it's very much going to be the House of Bathra.
Who's that?
Bathra are the merchants, the tiefling merchants.
Oh, the yes. So yeah, that's... I mean... Especially if they've just recently been there, because nobody's been hung for, you know, probably 10 years or something, right? Or,
yeah.
Who knows?
But they've, again, House of, or the Bathra House has maintained a close proximity to the town square, which on market days opens up and like fills out with market space. And a lot of people kind of sell and trade through the space. And the marketplace to the south of here is basically just kind of the main place where, on non-market days, where people just kind of do trading, it's more of a like a trade hall than anything else.
Okay, that makes sense.
So there are a couple more buildings here. We already know that the building in the catty corner behind the mayor's office is the Bjorkan estate. And it obviously has no people within it, unless they found some means of entering into the space through subterranean means.
What about spelled right?
Bjorkan? Bjorkan?
Oh, it looks like a C. I'm so confused.
It is a C.
It's not beer can. That's
no, I thought it was B-C-O-R.
Oh, the E is a C. I got you. What about the building next to the Coffin Maker? It's a smaller building. Its entrance is actually on the opposite side of the space. It's on the north side of the building. But what would that be?
Could it be like a tax office or something?
Seamstress.
I think the tax office would be good. And taxes would be handled by the mayor's office and also the keep, if anyone. You said a seamstress?
Yeah, like some sort of like milliner or something.
This would probably be where you went to actually get your garments done prior to. Yeah, you did say that was something you did. That's absolutely worked for me. Now,
yeah, that's good.
The building between Bjorkan and the seamstress, directly behind the mayor's office, to me kind of fits the model of like a house of some sort.
and, like a noble person's house or something.
Yeah, it'd be somebody probably who's not like super notable, but absolutely someone who. Let's take a look and see what our guild masters, which ones we are kind of missing here, and which one might be closest connected to the mayor's office. Someone who might need a bit more kind of connectivity with them. Let's see. Going to my notes here. We have Genies. And we've already covered the cobblers. We already know who the guildmaster for the scriveners are. So we have cooks and bakers, dancers and entertainers, glassblowers and glaziers. Actually, green bottles, the glassblowers.
Right. So maybe...
masons and stonecutters. And, the painters, limners, and sign makers. That's actually closely connected to the scriveners, but is separate. So this could be the home of that guildmaster, whose name will be...
Bach. No, wait, that would be seamstress. I'm thinking of Elden Ring. Bach, the seamstress.
I know exactly.
I thought of 17th century composer. And was like,
right? What? I was like, I don't get it.
So you didn't say musician or entertainer's guild. That was Bach.
I know. I'm thinking.
See, I thought about chickens.
What did you say? You thought about chicken? What
about chicken?
Bach.
Oh my gosh. I was also
really tired.
Somebody's smoking.
It's cool.
Something.
There's three kinds of people in this world. Clearly.
So,
oh my gosh. You're turning red too.
Oh my god.
And help me with this, especially Zach, because you'd be closely affiliated with these individuals. I would say due to the nature of the closeness to the Bjorkan estate. The individual whose estate this is, which the last name will be Amidon, A-M-I-D-O-N, they are also Elvish and have been in the town for quite some time. Is there any kind of aspects of the Elvishness that you want to kind of denote? Anything that you kind of want to focus on regarding this individual, the Scrivener Guildmaster?
No, I would say they're probably one of the oldest guild masters, along with Espen and myself. Even older than Mikhail, probably.
Well, I mean more so Mikhail's.
Yeah, the family. Like he would have been there in the time when the Vine family was like started in the town and like has probably been running it for a while now. Okay. Let's go female, actually.
All right.
Let's.
And what kind of elf?
Well, you have different kind of elves. Hold on.
Yeah. So there's moon elf and wild elf would be the two that are not
right.
That are native.
Go moon elf.
Okay. So Kasa. Which is strangely spelled because, of course, Elvish. Amidon is a moon elf. She is the master of the Sign Makers Guild. And she is quite an old piece of the puzzle here. Cool. Sorry, just making sure my notes are updated.
So what is a Scrivener's Guild then?
Scriveners deal with scribing. So they're the ones who basically put pen to paper and keep historical notes, documents, and the like. A Lorekeeper is the person who categorizes it and hires out the Scriveners to perform these duties. So the Lorekeeper is actually the one who's keeping the repository of information. The mayor's office also requires the Scriveners because the mayor's office keeps records of every mayoral kind of precedent. So taxes that are collected, laws that are...
registries for all the guild members.
Correct.
Different due like, processes.
Minutes
like,
for their meetings.
For materials from different like projects in the town. Like I imagine a lot of the actual keeps bookkeeping is done from the mayor's office.
Yeah, that would make sense.
And you guys have the Scriveners are helping you pretty much.
well, the Scriveners do all the, it's, they're like, they're your data entry people.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's what Scriveners are, is they're the people who sit and make the data go from, like, in, onto paper. You know, they'll take a bunch of receipts, put them into spreadsheets, you know, or like they'll take like an acquisition form with like new materials coming in on a caravan that are like for the keep and like track them, put them into an inventory. Like as things are used for the ceremony tonight, we're going to lose this much of this inventory from our stores, from like grain or whatever. And so like we have to keep track of how much grain we have stored for like
winter. That's a solid point too. Connectivity. So your guild probably has individuals who work in the Scrivener's Guild that manage the Vine accounts.
Right. Makes sense.
So yeah, it's
and just... there's people who do like the data transfer, who like a couple of times a week will come to the mayor's office, hand off like more information about inventory and management. That's
you remember the documents that were moved via big box to the Noldo's house. Similarly, like, they don't keep their own records. They have their records made by someone else, but they will keep duplicates so that they actually have the documents as well. So those Scriveners basically do everything in duplicate, possibly triplicate, depending if the keep requires a copy of the records in the lore master's vault as well. So
yeah. So actually it makes sense that they're like closer to the center of town because they'd be a very important guild.
100% you know? Accurate. Yeah. So we've got two elves living next to each other. Do we want to deal with the house on the north side of Amadon Estate? It's kind of a smaller partition connected to it. It's like that small little bit to the north of that. Do you want to figure out what that is, or is that not worth your investigation?
Well if it's a sign making guild, they're gonna need a lot of space. Wouldn't that be more of a workshop if this is an estate?
The hall itself, actually.
Yeah, they actually like you need a ton of space if you're making signage. Like so they're just all the that's what I like. It's just you need fucking floor space. So if that's what they are, like give them that whole back building as just giant empty
that's
warehouse.
Like a work spot.
Yeah,
exactly what it is. There's and no walls, no brilliant. High ceiling, just a big open warehouse if we need
and
a
it's
big
right
open
next
warehouse
to the lore master.
Well, really interesting point of order too is the sign makers hall and the kind of leadership therein is next to the seamsters, and sometimes signs are done on tapestry. Well, so this
canvas
is
or whatever.
Let
really
me
great.
Tell you how many times I've been contracted into doing that.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You had a great look on your face.
Absolutely.
I know I didn't have it currently on that, but we are forming this section of the town as we continue. The building to the south of the Bjorkan estate, kind of lower grounded than the Bjorkan, but is technically connected therein. Just not like there's no egress, there's no means of entry in one to the other, but the walls are kind of blocked. What would this building be, do you think? Another estate or something different?
Well, it looks like the entrance is actually
outside
on the east side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so my assumption is that the Bjorkan estate kind of entered low and then kind of go up. This is like a one-story building that's on the same level as the second floor of the Bjorkan and the attic of the Bjorkan estate. And it actually has like a drop off that goes down to the ground level, its basement effectively. So you'd enter into the first floor at the top on the right side. And then if you wanted to descend into their basement, it's not a subterranean basement. It's kind of like an above ground basement.
So it's like a split level.
Yeah, split level. Exactly.
Yeah.
So this would be a house then, you think?
What if it's a bookshop?
Yeah, it could be.
With a little cafe.
But regarding bookshops, there probably wouldn't be much desire for one. I'll be honest.
Could a library with a cafe?
So the mayor's office has its own internal library. The keep has its own internal library. The temple has its own internal library, you saw from the shelves. The lore master's tower presents opportunities for library access.
So nobody needs to buy books.
Nobody wants to buy books.
I want all the books.
You know what people do need, though?
What?
Candles.
Candles.
They do. That's a big
one. I just lit mine a little bit ago.
Candle maker?
Candlemaker.
Yeah.
That's
a good one. Well, what about this building here? That could be a candlemaker, and it opens onto the market.
True.
The chandlery. Now, the second part of the chandlery is it's not a guild. It's a single individual. And they don't just make candles. They would be responsible for making a number of different means of lighting. Lanterns, all different types of light making. The main one that I want to kind of accentuate is the town at night is well lit. And that will be due in part to the chandlery's work. They will have a means of lighting the town.
Are you raising your hand?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Can I make another argument for this building? It also has entrance right at the Temple of Life, who I would assume uses many, many candles.
Oh, okay. So you want to do that one as a temple or the chandlery and the other one different?
Like, unless there's a different use for this building that would
tie
into the Temple of Life, but like,
there's like a specific entrance.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
I like that. And also what that lets us do is if we wanted to, and I know it's something that I've been thinking about, is it looks like the houses kind of adjacent to Bjorkan have so far been estates. And we've already covered in past lore that the building...
It would be good to be an estate. Yeah.
Yeah. This building here...
Yeah, it would be good.
But the building kind of northeast of that Bjorkan is also an estate. So it seems like these would be houses. Okay.
Yeah, like this is kind of like the posh district.
Yeah, that's like an old part of the town. Like it's the middle sex part of it, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. So this one, I don't think I want to put another elf in it just because it's kind of samey and the town isn't fully elfish. And we do have a gnome kind of cavalcade inside the Temple of Life. But it looks like that the building next to it, kind of directly next to it, will probably be their kind of expanse. Like that building that's on the waterfront there. That'll be the, like, gnomish kind of, for lack of a better word, barracks.
Gnomish barracks. I love it.
They
have to sleep your in army barracks. Of children.
All the gnomes have to sleep in barracks in our town.
The Nalr. It'll be the Nalr.
You convince me to play a gnome, and then you this is what break you me.
So I would say that this house in between.
That's great.
What do we want this house to be? Like race wise.
That's a good question.
One of them weird ones.
I mean, we have an elf. What else?
One of them weird ones.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Wait a minute. I think it should be an old family that's been around for a long time, and it should be
Kennelborn.
Kennelborn. Yes, that's what. See, you were thinking when I was thinking, because they've been around a long time. So this is like the oldest, richest Kennelborn family.
Gotcha.
Maybe they're not into like maybe they've never been leadership or anything, but they're like the oldest, most rich Kennelborn family.
That works for me because I already had an idea for a noble family that would be politically interesting later in the scene. So I'll go ahead and make that the Braxis estate.
Brexit?
Braxsus. Okay,
they're in the Irmer. There's one of them up at the Irmerag, right?
Braxis? No.
No, you said Braxis. That's what I mean. I wrote Braxis, but that was one of the names of one of their guards that they brought down.
No, it couldn't have been.
It could have been. I got it. I mean, maybe I wrote it down wrong, but that's what I wrote.
Really?
Did you wait? I know who to ask. Ask. I don't know. Elizabeth, Zach. they have good notes.
Braticus, Chatticus, Otavius. Yeah, Braxis is one.
Braxis. Yeah.
Braxis is too close for me.
Yeah, well, just name something different. Sorry.
Yeah, that's fine. I will name them something different.
Yeah.
God damn it.
Sorry, there's too many names.
Take better notes. No, I'm kidding.
I did take great notes. I just used
it. Oh my gosh.
How's it feel to have my notes be better
than the DM's notes?
Why don't you run the game?
Zach has good notes. What can I say, man? Zach and Elizabeth have good notes.
Why don't you run the game?
No,
I want to look back on like 2016 Zach playing D&D.
All right,
taking notes and shit.
Is the last name Avarad good?
Sounds great.
Sounds good to me, man.
Is that one I've used before? In this
no,
game?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Okay.
Well, no.
I'll fight every single one of you.
Let's go. No, I'm kidding.
I will cheat to win.
I love it. I love it.
I got a rose bush.
What's that?
We're totally world building.
Another natural 20. Holy shit. okay, so there's only two more houses that we haven't covered. The two that are kind of the south, but does this cover, like, I mean, in all honesty, does this cover kind of like what you were planning on investigating anyway?
Yeah, yeah, I would think so. Yeah, I mean, we don't need to flesh them out now unless you want to. I do find it very interesting to do this as a group, you know.
Absolutely.
We come up with good stuff, man. We should be making modules and adventures.
What I like about it most is it gives you the false assumption that I don't already have something planned for these things. It just gives you a sense of like knowledge of the world and like a connectivity to it because it's you that's helping make it. So yeah absolutely, because you become more invested when that's the case.
Right.
But yeah, so you have the house, to answer your question as to what these buildings are, Kevin, the House of Bathra to the left, the Coffin Maker directly behind the gallows, Seamstress next to that, Abaddon Estate, which is a Moon Elf leader of the Scrivener's Guild, Bjorkan Estate, which you are aware is currently emptied, the Avarad Estate, House Avarad, or the Avarad family, are a noble house of Kennelborn, upturned Kennelborn, who have been in the town for quite some time, possibly cousins of the Bjorvin family, and Chandlery to the south of that across the way. The other two buildings near the Temple of Light, not terribly important. And of course, Nalric home just next to the Temple of Light.
Yeah, I like the idea of them being like cousins or something because, you know, they're like a house that's been around a long time and, you know, so that seems neat. All right, I guess what Mikhail would want to do would be to see like who's been around recently and if anybody has seen anything, and also like if I see anything, like if I happen to like come up with some crazy like you know, like somebody left a glove like right near the gallows, it's like if the glove fits you must acquit. No, if it doesn't fit, you must acquit. Something
secretly
like that.
It was OJ and he's riding a white
exactly.
Bronco.
So where?
I want to investigate better than the cops did for OJ is basically what I want
to. Where would you like to start your investigation? And of course, Chris, you are present.
Right.
So
right.
If you want to kind of nominate a place as well, you can.
Yeah.
Once you kind of decided on a direction, I'm going to shift gears and talk to someone else.
All right, fine. I would like to start out the gallows and then kind of work my way to the houses. What do you think, Chris? I mean, you know, the sheriff would have a huge part in this, obviously. I'm just helping.
Yeah. I would just agree with that. I think given it's at the moment, it's really just the two of us. I feel like it would be better for two people together to go to the houses rather than just one. Well,
Roman is also present, by the way.
He doesn't work here.
He would have a lot of knowledge about the old town that might be helpful. So we could bring him along, but you know.
Yeah. But like where are the people who are on the town's payroll?
Right, right.
Sorry, I apologize. I threw a Joe Pesci at your lethal weapon.
Joe Pesci.
See, I like starting at the gallows and then just like go into the houses, see, and like maybe they were up in their room and saw something out the window.
Okay, so which house, the Coffin Maker, you said?
No, let's start with the Bathras and then work our way around. I mean, that way it's just easy to do.
As you start making your way over there, I'm going to cut the scene to the Temple of Light. Summer, you follow in behind the guards as they deposit the corpses, and you can see the look on the pair of individuals who are present here. Watching this happen, it's just kind of like a look of confusion. The individuals you are looking at would be Violet and Gertie. No idea what they're supposed to be doing regarding this. You also remember that your husband, Bindle, right?
Yes.
He is still at the keep. But Gertie and Violet are kind of confused, and the guards don't really say much, but they say, the captain said to bring these bodies here, priestess. If you wish to investigate them or prepare them for last rites, any information you're able to glean from the corpses, please report to the captain.
Of course. Leave it to me. I will take care of everything.
They leave, and Violet immediately says, corpses? What's happening out there?
I honestly have no idea, but we were going to the gallows, and...
Gertie's pulling off the tarps. You can see like this look of like morbid curiosity kind of in Gertie's eyes, and doesn't appear to be dissatisfied.
She'd be into true crime.
Yeah. Gertie's the name of a true crime lover.
Yeah. That tracks.
She's looking it over. If you'd like to investigate the corpses, you can make a medicine check. Because Gertie is present, you'll have advantage because she will be assisting with the investigatory process.
Right. I would like to investigate them to see what I can glean.
They are certainly dead. But with a 23, you will know that it does appear that there was some sign of struggle, but the wounds are not indicative of someone who was given an even chance. Looks like either knife or short sword cutting wounds. It definitely appears like they were strangled for a time, but as you kind of look them over, you and Gertie kind of like see a bit of clotting on the back of the neck that wouldn't be readily visible with the noose and setting them down and the whatnot. And as you kind of turn them over and look at the back of the neck, you see that both of them have the same wound directly on the lower, like, back. Well, not lower back, sorry. The lower portion of the neck, the nape of the neck. It looks like there's, like, a puncture wound. And it kind of has, like, a bruising to it. And it looks like it was kind of administered in the same spot with both of them. A needle-like just jut in the back of the neck, like a stiletto or something.
And just one.
One stab on both of them, yeah, like they were executed.
Ooh. They did not get eaten by the fleas.
they would look like empty Capri Suns if they got eaten by the fleas. Come on. We covered this last session.
They'd be all shriveled up.
A horse-sized flea would just wouldn't even take a second.
Yeah, that would be rather
horrifying.
Yeah, horrifying, but also amusing. I don't know. Mentally, it's amusing.
Fair enough.
And that's all I can glean from it, right?
Yeah. So it looks like the cause of death was definitely the puncture.
Puncture. But they also probably fought a little, but...
Yeah, it looks like they were being dragged around by their hands and their neck. Like, they were tied up in this way.
Right. Well, it seems that they were taken prisoner. Maybe? Not really sure. Wasn't there. Definitely need the sheriff on this one. Don't know why they would hang them though. Weird.
It's kind of like a big message, Gertie says. Like, look at these dead guys. Like, I mean, sure, they could have just left them on the ground or anything, but like, I think the gallows kind of like gives it a taste of like it was justice, you know?
Yeah, you're right.
And it probably would have.
Smart.
It probably would have been hard to like actually hang them. So that's probably why they did what they did.
True. That would probably attract a lot of attention, especially to the ones hanging them.
Yeah, I don't...
But they weren't there this morning when I went on my walk.
Yeah. No, yeah. Like...
That's...
No, yeah.
Yeah, no. No, yeah.
I mean, I don't know what you were hoping for.
I'm from another planet. This is exactly what you were saying.
It's like California surfers in the Temple of Life. I pick up my calling stone and call the sheriff.
Cut there. We're going to Evangeline. Back inside of the keep. The abbess, after the first course has been kind of taken away, she looks to you and she says, a number of your close counsel have left. Are you sure everything is okay?
I'm sure they'll inform me if there's anything to worry about. But if they felt it was necessary, I do trust them.
Do you mind if I send someone along to possibly attend them and assist in whatever is going on so that they
Not
can
at all.
Return back to the festivities as quickly as possible?
Not at all. I think that would be appreciated.
She looks over to Broderick. He stands up, brushes his cape, kind of looks down to you and kind of gives you a bow. Where might I find who I'm seeking?
I would look for the guard captain. Last I knew, he was patrolling the town.
I will reach out to Romand. As I understand it, that is who he is with, correct? Morax, the captain of the guard?
Yes. No, I believe they're both watching the town.
He turns and heads out. A lot of people kind of take signifier of this, and you kind of realize that there's now kind of a tenseness, for lack of a better word. Like, there's just a very much kind of understanding that something's off, more so than it already was. Anything you'd like to try to do to... I can also give you the cop out of Dahabe, do something to pep it up, and we can just say that.
Like, I feel like she would step in, probably something to do with music, or
absolutely,
maybe like that would be the time she'd be like, poem.
She
and
very,
like, recited that poem.
She very quickly, in a Zizhogian kind of way, steals the scene. Okay, so then we're gonna cut to Zach. You make it to Iron Shoe Stables quickly, because you are very fast. Upon arriving there, you can see that the stable master is present. He seems to just be sitting in his desk again, or at his desk again. You weren't here last time.
Sorry.
I've had a bunch of caffeine and I'm still yawning. I don't understand. And he says to you upon entering, oh, hail. Mayor, can I help you with something? Do you need a ride out of town, or?
No. More pressing matter, actually. It's my understanding there's two Blusa here. Yes?
There were. Yesterday.
By were. Have they been retrieved?
They were present here yesterday, but then the captain of the watch came by at dusk and said he would be taking them.
Excellent. Of course, I should have checked in with the captain first. Naturally. About what time was this?
Well, after evening, well past supper time. I was actually alarmed at the entrance, and of course I heard the strings play, and I came down immediately, and he said that he needed to commandeer the creatures, and then he took them out of town. I don't know when he returned, and if he did return through the Iron Shoe Gate, I did not see him.
I see. Was this, was he by himself?
He was. He led the creatures out. He didn't ride them.
That makes more sense, yes. Well, I say, do you have any information on the fellows who left the Belusa?
The two gentlemen said they were representatives of the Denisatvan court. They had hoped to treat with Lady Beovin. I'm assuming they fell into problems with the captain?
It would seem to be the case, yes. Looks like I'm playing catch up on this all.
Well, make sure the captain knows if those creatures are fair game. I would very much like to put forward a donation to the city to ensure that they come to me. Those would be great steeds to have on hand.
I'd be happy to pass along your interests, sir.
Thank you.
Of course. Steps out of the stables, and as he starts running, like panting, there as they're running, they're like, "Guys, so there's the guy, the shapeshifter. He picked up the blusa."
So, Moirax and Mikhail, after kind of looking over the gallows and not really seeing anything besides what you've already kind of gleaned, you make your way to the door of the coffin maker, and as you're about ready to knock. Casey, you're calling the captain?
Yeah, they'd call the captain.
Summer, you're calling the captain? Yeah. Your stone is blowing up, Chris.
It is the captain.
And you can take them both at the same time if you want.
I'm calling him too. No, I'm kidding.
You heard what Zach was saying, so Zach is very much saying that.
I'm getting another call. Let me conference y'all in. All right, you're up. We're in a group call.
Sorry. So there's the changeling. I think.
Why is he panting?
He's running.
I don't know, he doesn't even breathe.
He's a robot. they
don't even keep
there. I love it. I love it.
It's his programming.
His programming is comical effect.
Yes.
It's just drama.
He's been hanging around breathers for too long.
So, the Blusa, they seem to have been picked up by a changeling. Can you tell I'm running really fast? I'll be back soon. Working real hard, guys.
Oh, that's great.
I look over at Mikhail and like, you hear that?
Yes, I did. This is very troubling.
First, the knives are below us, and now they're
among us.
Now it looks like the sun is setting on us.
This sounds like dusk, right? Wasn't there Wasn't there a person called Dusk we were waiting for, or we were looking for? That was
not a changeling. Doppelganger.
Yeah, doppelganger. A doppelganger, which is really bad. So yeah, this is going from bad to worse.
Oh boy!
All right, what does Summer have to say?
So my matter is not quite as urgent because they're already dead, but I think they had a little bit of a struggle, but they died pretty quickly. Probably that's the good news. Do you have any more info? Because do I need to keep them around?
Well, we got this scroll here. Yeah. The scroll was attached to him. It reads, and I read the scroll to them because I didn't write it down fast enough. I read the scroll to Summer.
And they were also members of the Denisian court. It might be best we hold on to them.
Yes, we definitely need to hold on to them. Right, we definitely need to hold on to them, I would say.
They were official members of the court.
Summer, did you find a means of death? Were they hung or was it something else?
Oh no, they that's what I mean by they died pretty quickly. So it seems like they were like tied up a bit, and then that was the struggle. And then there was like this puncture wound in the back.
Summer, you are an excellent investigator.
Judge me, Jonathan.
I appreciate it. It doesn't. It's not what you guys think.
It's absolutely hilarious to me.
I'm gonna be honest. I didn't even. No, I didn't even know it was supposed to wound.
So
yeah. See, now we know. That's why I asked her, because I figured she would tell us.
I don't know what just happened.
It was hilarious. You missed it. Very good.
Elizabeth is turning red again.
So, Kevin said, were they hung? And I was like,
yes. Oh, again?
Yes. And then, that was it.
In Elizabeth's response, there were a couple of suggestive things as well. And every time she would say one, I'd be like, and then she looked up while it was happening and died. And then she died.
And died. Yeah, she died.
I died.
And she's turning
red. Rest in peace.
Yeah.
My goodness.
I turn red really easy, okay?
I know. I love it. It's great.
I'm fair skinned.
It's great. I love it because it's like, you know, we say something to embarrass you and then you turn red. So,
Katie, you arrive. You're there.
I tell.
You're that fast. I do the math.
He zoom.
24 seconds, I think.
He's, no, he's give or take. Naruto runs.
Dashing.
I have a coworker that does that.
Yeah. It's like six rounds tops.
Makes sense.
I mean, Casey's also a monk, so don't
that's
they true. Have
that's
a
why.
Speed?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So that's I good. Would... Mikhail fills Casey in on what we found out from Summer and stuff, because
that's we were conference called in.
Oh, you were conference called.
Yeah, I know. You don't need to catch me up.
You're good. All right.
Yeah, they heard everything.
All right. Cool.
Kevin's like, conference call. What's that?
Yeah, what's a conference call? What the hell?
What's a conference?
It's like the sheriff. He's a young man. Technology? He knows how to operate all this technology. I'm just an old dude. It's like I gotta. What do they call those ones with the real big buttons? There's a special name for them.
Jitterbug.
Yes, I got a jitterbug. Oh, yes. I got a jitterbug rock.
But now you three are standing outside of the coffin maker. Yes. You do notice that Blind kind of moves to the side, and you can see someone kind of looking out. Confused.
I would wave at him. Like
should we place an order?
Yes. Yes,
I'm gonna go ahead and knock on it.
Yeah, knock on the door.
Oh, and then you hear him come around and unlock the door and then open it. And he looks at you and he says, yes. Can I help you?
What did this guy have a name?
It's probably one you haven't focused on too much, but he can have a name, I suppose.
Coffin Maker.
But would I know his name?
Do you? Do you get my meaning?
Yeah, sure.
Because I can come up with one if you can't.
Maybe like Folger. I'm gonna, like Coffee Maker. Not instead of Coffin Maker, Coffee Maker.
Maxwell Folger.
I don't like it.
Okay.
I'll take Maxwell.
Okay.
His last name will be Gudger.
Yeah, there you go. Perfect. Gudger.
That's...
Gudger. What's wrong with it?
No. Perfect.
Weird. The name makes me uncomfortable. Which I guess works for his profession.
He's a coffin maker.
He's effective. So coffin makers also double as cabinet makers. Just so you know.
Right. Which makes sense because they just make boxes out of wood.
Right. They make more than boxes, just boxes. It's more than
long boxes, skinny boxes, fat boxes. What you want?
Fancy boxes.
We can put food in them. We can put people in them. We can put people that are food in them.
So I got it. Maxwell Gudger.
I'm already Wilson creeped Gudger. Out by it. You do not need to take it up a notch, okay? Thank you. He says, can I help you?
Yeah, sorry to disturb you, Mr. Gudger, but there's been a recent situation and I just wanted to ask if perhaps you've seen anything in the past at your windows or heard anything in the past hour or so.
Well, I heard a bit of a commotion just about few minutes ago, but that was you folks, I think.
All right, you didn't hear anything before that?
No, can't say that I have. There was a bunch of guards pulling some bodies off the gallows. I didn't know you were hanging anybody up.
That's the situation. We didn't hang anybody up.
Oh. Oh, I see. No, I haven't seen anybody around. It's been pretty quiet, other than, I mean, early in the morning, the Bathras and their retinue headed up to the keep. Something going on over there, I guess. Other than that, nothing much, no?
All right. I appreciate your help.
Wait. I would whisper in the sheriff's ear, mm-hmm. Ask him if he's seen any Denistavians.
Denistavians!
Yes, those things. Whatever. Don't laugh at me.
Seen
I love it!
Denistavians. Round.
Dennis Atvins, continue.
Dennis? Atvin.
Okay.
Dennis Atvins.
And the only difference between a Dennis Atvin and
Dennis Rodman,
a regular human, is that their arms are slightly longer. Like, their arms go down to about their, like, lower thigh. Like, all the way down a bit.
I have a friend whose arms do that.
Forever having to roll up sleeves whenever you buy long sleeve shirts. Like the bane of my existence.
If you're familiar with, like, Soulsborne games, like, they have, like, slightly longer arms. That's what I'm kind of going for.
That's cool. It's kind of like
somebody
like
just, like, moved their arm slider up just a little bit extra.
Yeah, a little bit extra.
Like a really good swimmer has really good long arms and it's tall, you know? Anyway.
Also, they usually have longer torsos.
Dennis Atvin.
Yeah.
Ask him if they have any of those.
Dennis is at the van.
He would reply if Dennis you do ask that question. Yeah. Without...
I did. Have you seen any of the Dennis Atvins around here?
Certainly not. I would hate to have that happen from what I hear. My brother down in Cola said that they're not the nicest of folk.
Let's not address this racism right now. We'll do it later.
I'm going to agree with that first part, that I'd hate for that to happen.
All right, well.
Yep. Do you mind if we just come, if we have any more questions, we come around and ask?
Yeah, it's fine.
Always appreciate the help to get to the bottom of these kinds of situations in town.
The two of you would notice that, like, as you've been kind of sitting with him, Casey, not so much because lack of this specific sensory perception. This individual, this gentleman, Gudger, has a smoky smell to him. Like, he smells like Mikhail, you would recognize it as kind of like a very rich pipeweed kind of smell. Like, he's been kind of just relaxing on the Day of Dan.
Like, maybe doing a little bit of that hobbit weed?
No. Definitely a pipeweed, so tobacco, for sure.
Oh, okay, but nothing like...
No.
You know.
Yeah, right. I mean, it may not be something you're aware of, but in the campaign setting, I mean, there is cannabis. Like, that's a thing that exists. There's also devil weed, which is, like, crazier from the Wissian plant. I'm being raided? Cool. Wyvern Knight, that
Hello.
Sounds familiar. Is that Tom?
I don't
not,
know. Which Tom?
Not classic Tom, no.
Like
England Tom.
Yeah. England Tom?
Yeah, maybe.
From England?
Very, very cool.
Hello.
But yeah. That said, he doesn't seem cool. to know much of what you're gunning for here. Really no idea as to what you're kind of mentioning. And he'll leave it at that. Do you want to check on another house, or?
I guess
I mean, nowhere to go, but just move on.
Okay. So the bathroom house looks empty, and you would note that the attendants of the, or rather the masters of the bathroom house are currently at the keep anyways. They are a part of the festivities therein. The seamstress's house looks like it is occupied, but quiet.
I actually don't think I got... What time is it?
Oh, sure. It's about midday. So,
oh, like, okay. Okay, so we're not, like, waking people up.
No, no, no. Okay. So you had the morning, like, you know, services at the Alloyne Church, and those would have been probably, like, you know, crack of dawn to about, like, 9, 10-ish. And that's really when the festivities at the Keep started, and they've only been going on for a little while, because it was kind of like the mention of the issue with the Denisovans, and then it was this.
All right, so just we'll move on to the seamstress. Unless you two have anything else to say.
I mean, that seems good to me.
Seamstress?
Sure.
No? Okay. If you knock at the door, the individual that meets with you at the door is a woman, very pale skin, kind of a deep purple hair color.
Is it Elizabeth?
Deep purple hair color.
Well, I mean, she has black hair.
And she appears to be just very intense. Yeah, that's a good way to phrase it. She's wearing a gown, very out of character for someone who would just be kind of lounging around in their home. The gown appears to have these very beautifully kind of designed floral motifs, which look like they are like roses, like fashioned of silk. Deep purples all about her gown. She appears to have, like, fully, you know, placed makeup upon herself. She looks like she's ready to kind of receive or attend or do something, but she very much just seems to be kind of sitting about when you kind of knock, and she kind of moves up to speak to you. And she says, can I help you, gentlemen?
Yeah, there's been a recent situation in town square. We're just asking people who live around, have you heard anything lately?
I can't say that I have, but there was, I did see some folk kind of move out from behind the mayor's office. It was maybe about an hour or so ago. Seems like they were moving something.
What do these folks look like?
I only caught sight of one of them. He or she or they, I don't know for certain. Larger. Pale. Longer hair, about shoulder length. Longer than his, anyways, gesturing to Mikhail. And there were at least two other people with this person. I didn't get a good eye on them. They were wearing hoods.
Do you happen to see what they were carrying?
It looked like a box? Like a... Or a sack? Like a... Something. I'm sorry, I didn't get a good look at it. It took all three of them to carry it, though.
So it was pretty big?
I don't think it was big, it was more heavy.
Could you tell about, like, I don't know, yeah, about how big this box was?
You see her kind of, like, looking around, and she goes, ah, and she gestures over to, she has a potted plant in her, like, room that's visible from the door. The potted plant, it's like a earthware pot. It's probably about 2.5 foot tall and probably about 2 feet wide in diameter.
All right. Big, pale, long hair. Catch what color that hair was?
Was blondish?
All right. This is very useful.
Oh, of course. If I remember anything, or if I see them again, I'll try to reach out to you or your guard.
Yeah, if you remember anything or you recognize anyone, just let any guard know, and they'll be sure to get it to me.
Perfect. Okay. Absolutely.
Appreciate your help, ma'am. Sorry to bother you on this day.
Not a problem. I must get back to what I was doing. And she closes the door.
Mikkel would ask her what she was doing before she closes the door.
Oh, I'm just spending some time with my husband.
Like, would I know, does the seamstress have a husband that lives with her and all that?
It's obviously something that would have been common knowledge in the town, but yeah. It's something that you may not it may not float to the top.
Right.
So what I'll do is I'll have you roll a history check. Pretty low DC, 13. History. And if you get it, then you'll know.
We'll see. Oh, man.
23. Yeah, you're very familiar with the town. So you would know that the seamstress' husband was killed by bandits a little while ago. I would say about 5 years ago. It wasn't any of the bandit groups that you were familiar with. Like you and Moirax would have been familiar with. It was just a small band of ne'er-do-wells, some punks. You're pretty sure you could probably find their names on the registrar of people who were kind of arrested and moved on from this base, because it was during the conflicts that were happening in between the Idhelm city, or the Idhelm town and your town.
And then I would say, well, thank you very much. Have a good night.
And just to kind of close that loop, if you do go investigate the bandits that killed the seamstress's husband, there was some guy named Dizzy, a dragonborn who fancied himself the term Wyvern, a guy named Pav.
I don't know. I think
I'm mostly
inserting them into the story.
He asked.
I love it.
I don't know. That kind of ruins a little bit of her what she saw, because it, like, if she's still doing stuff with her husband 5 years after he's dead.
Oh, she might be crazy, is what you're saying?
I mean, maybe. I don't want to say it, but.
So hold on. Let me counter that statement by stating a house not too far from here had a person die in it, and what happened to him?
Yeah, there could be ghosts. I mean, I did think of that too. I don't know if we really.
It's Halloween season.
Yeah. What she's doing in this exact moment is none of our business, and frankly, it's kind of outside of the investigation to ask what she's been doing. She's simply a witness, and I'm saying this into your head.
I agree. You're right. Let's continue. Or should we stop? I mean, maybe we could check the Amadon estate.
She's not there.
Yeah.
You would know she's not there. She is at present at the keep. She is a guild master. So
in that case, maybe we're done, because nobody else is going to see anything.
Yeah, I don't think got anybody else around this.
Yeah. The Bjorkan estate is obviously empty, and Avarad would not have had sight on it. They were not welcomed to the keep, though. Or were they? That's a good question. Evangeline would have invited the Averant family to the keep, or just the guildmasters? Because remember, you said just the guildmasters, but of course we did just make up the Averant family just a couple minutes ago. So
if they're a prominent, influential family in the town, yeah.
More than fair. They are at the keep, that's fine.
And they're also technically kind of family, so.
Yeah, that tracks. Okay. But yeah, that's it, really. Like, no eyewitnesses other than the seamstress.
All right.
And she specifically said she saw them moving from behind the mayor's office.
Right.
Which is right next to Mirkin's estate, which is a known entrance to the tunnels.
Right. All right. Well, I guess we can report.
Yeah, I think we'd best just meet back up with Priestess and try to work and see if we can work anything out.
Okay. So Casey, Mikhail, and Moirax move to the Temple of Life, where they meet with Summer, who has probably secured a means of kind of performing last rites on these individuals. And again, as you are the priestess, and I really haven't developed that much lore regarding how last rites for the Church of Alawain go, how would you like to say that those rites proceed?
Well, since there is a lot of water, I feel like that's a great way to, like, washing the body, saying prayers, and then we're not in the site. I don't know. That's as far as I got.
Well, whatever the rites are, again, haven't really fully developed them, but they're assumably kind of, you know.
Yeah. Would they also be regional rites? That's another thing that I'm contemplating.
It's up to you. Again, I haven't formulated much regarding the Church of Alawain other than they have a death cult in Osiria. And that's a totally different matter for a totally different day of the week.
Yeah.
Their death aspect has been perverted by the conglomerate in my Sunday game. So these are the only two things that I really track on the Alawain Church. Other than that, it's been
So I can start writing your religion for you.
Would there be some influence from Ermarag as well?
Ermarag.
Since like we like are essentially the gate beneath Ermarag.
To be certain. Regarding last rites, it would fall to the temple that they're in. At current, the representatives of Ermarag are not aware that there are corpses. And you know who else isn't? Evangeline.
Yeah. Well, no, like, as far as, like, rites are concerned and, regional aspects of that process, would that have been affected?
I would say
historically.
No. I would say no. Okay. Unless Elizabeth wants to say otherwise, but I would say no. It probably wouldn't be mandatory.
No.
Yeah. My main thing that I was getting at that was the whole like Osiria anti-dead thing. Like,
oh, sure. No. Thing. We don't burn corpses here.
Great. That's what I needed to know.
Out of character note for those who are watching, Osiria is a province to the north of here that is the host of my Friday game. The Osirian people are servants of Atavius, the god of law and chaos. They focus more on the law aspect, and they really don't like the breaking of the law of death in the form of undeath. And so their entire society is built on the hatred of undeath. It's crazy to think a society being built on the hatred of a thing or a concept, but yeah, it's really how it works.
Race.
Is that racism?
I would say no.
I don't think so.
No,
anyone can be undead.
Yeah. They hate all undead equally.
Yeah.
It's like the typical.
It's bigotry, but it's less
that's
specific
what I was
than
say.
That.
Yeah, it's not, what I was going
it's,
for.
It's not quite racism.
You know the comedic comedian trope of I hate all people equally. Well, Osiria just hates all not
dead
living.
I suppose it's more of a religious zealotry than...
Yeah, it absolutely is a religious zealotry. Okay. That's it.
Yeah.
Undeathophobia.
Undeathophobia. Fair enough.
It's more of a hatred than a fear, though. But yeah. Cool. So you go back to the Temple of Life. Summer has performed rites, or is in the process of kind of finalizing those rites.
I think probably still in the process. Not a lot
a longer process. Okay, we love that. So you would basically be seeing, pull up my notepad. Gotta keep track of these fucking gnomes. It is Gertie.
The gnome tracker.
Gertie and Violet are the ones assisting. Summer at current. So what you would know is Bindle is back at the keep because obviously Dahlia is not present. She actually is out of the town for a little bit. She left yesterday. Rocky is probably asleep and Sky is probably cleaning and doesn't really care.
Well, if Sky's not at the keep, then yeah, he's around.
Yeah. Like, yeah, he's just doing busy work.
Yeah. Well, because, well, I mean, if Gertie isn't at the keep, if she's with Sky's me, Sky's around. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
I got you. Because Blockin.
I'll be honest. I don't know which ones are your kids. If you have a husband, are
they?
Spindle's the husband.
Spindle.
No tracker dot XLSX. I definitely need to start developing.
Is it
program.
Spindle or Bindle?
Bindle.
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 With the B.
Bindle.
Oh my God! Their ship name is Spindle, though.
No, Miss Bindle is Summer. Summer Wait, is Bindle's wife.
She's saying that Bindle and Summer put together is Spindle.
Oh, I thought she said
it's Miss like Bradgelina.
Yeah,
Miss Bindle. Never mind. The point is you arrive and she's in the process of performing last rites. Morax, Mikhail, and Casey. Holy crap! I love this, but. We left
them forward. Oh my God. Working away. You're muted, Chris.
Hear me now?
Yeah. Yes. I'm sure it was great.
I'm sure it was
I actually only like just barely opened my mouth and then you like said something. Well, I don't know if you found anything else, but we don't have much.
Well, I've already told you what I found and like doing the stuff. So that's really it right now. I don't know what else if there was anything you needed to see on them, but I'd rather not them turn into ghosts, so I'm a little busy.
Yeah, you do your thing.
Hey, Summer. Sorry to interrupt you, but is your last rites, does that violate any Dennis Atfan rules for last rites?
I'm not sure, but I'm trying to be as respectful as I can, as usual. I mean, everyone worships differently.
Okay.
Even within the town.
I just wanted to make sure, because...
If that's more a question you're positing to your own memory, do you have history trained, Kevin?
I do.
Go ahead, make a history check.
I have most things trained. I'm pretty...
That. Skillful.
Oh, one. I asked a question because I had no fucking idea.
Snake eyes.
I rolled two ones. That's why I asked Summer. I knew Summer would know.
Beautiful. You have no idea if Dennis F.
I have no idea.
Do I know?
You can also make a history check.
Do you know?
We're doing our best.
Yeah.
No, you're not sure. You don't know who they worship or what their traditions are.
But we're being as respectful as we can.
And just to kind of put it to you, just so we understand Dennis Atvin kind of ecology, I guess, their connection to you. The Dennis Atvins come from a place called Scoria to the West, which is kind of its own kind of wasteland. Most people in Jarnaris don't care for it. It's kind of a wildlands. The Dennis Atvins claim that they are descendants, direct descendants, of the Svirkic people, which are the people that Jarnaris kind of grew up out of. This mention is them basically saying they're connected and tied to the dragon, like the original Jarnaran dragon. That's a very bold claim as far as lineages go. So they claim that they have rights that should supersede the current dynast, who is the ruler of Jarnaris as a whole.
Right, okay.
And that's their main beef, is they're trying to reclaim lands that they think are theirs.
Cool.
Unfortunately, due to the splintered nature of Jarnaris at current, there is no unified force that's standing against the Denis Atvins. Because if there was, it would basically smash them. They're not a massive army or anything.
Yeah. It's just like, we'll let them... There's no
massive army on the other side that's unified.
Oh, yeah. Just to clarify, it was those Denis Atvins who destroyed Ulamin?
Capital? The capital of Ulamar. That's
capital of Ulamar?
Ulamond.
Ulamond.
I said it wrong in my brain. But yeah, it's the capital of Ulamon that was sacked by the Denis Atvin people. And to give you a bit of a connective point there, we're going to move the map real quick. Hold on a second here.
So they're like the Goths or something. Kind of in history. That's the Visigoths.
Fair. Moving in on the map here, you can see back that
Rome.
Here's Gateneath. There's Ermarag. There's Kolot. And then the capital of Ulamond was here, and its name is currently escaping me, but I can look it up here in a second. It's just not currently important. Although now it's becoming important, and that's annoying me. And my notes.
No biggie.
But yeah, it's a ways away, to be sure.
Lucky you, I don't have it written down. I have it written as the capital.
I have Ulamar / capital, but I don't know if that's right.
I got you. Hold on a second here.
But it might just be the capital of Ulamon or Ulamar or whatever.
Persistence at the
threat. Who knows? Like I said, my notes are crazy.
Yeah? My notes are crazier.
Yeah.
Capital of Ulamon is Entolas, which is Entolas. And that was mentioned in the handout, the year 1054, 2 years ago. The capital of Ulamon Entolas is sacked by Denis Atvin forces. The barony of Ulamon's border towns become self-sufficient city-states opposed to Denis Atvin opposition, or they become allied with the Denis Atvin invaders. And so to kind of put this in perspective a little bit more kind of globally, we're looking at the map here. So to kind of understand the breadth of the Denis Atvin advance, it came from like all the way to the west and moved to Ulamon specifically, sacking or controlling the towns in between. Most of the towns are just small little bits here that have yet to be named. Questions regarding that bit of lore?
Maybe we shouldn't really be worried about like offending these guys, because you know, maybe we should just be at war with them. I don't know.
Politically, what we understand is it was probably the case that these Denis Atvin messengers were hopeful that the leadership of this town would basically swear fealty to the Denis Atvins. It's very much the case that the Abbess is like, no,
yeah.
Fuck all of that.
I think I like Abbott.
She's pretty cool.
I think she has the right of it. The more I think about it, these guys are just jerks.
I don't disagree. But that said, do you have any other questions regarding the politics of it, or do you want to head back into the town space and ask some questions there? Is there anything that you're kind of looking towards? Because again, you just regrouped at the temple, and just leaving it
to honestly, you. I think Casey would be urging to get back to the keep. We've been gone for so long now, we've definitely caused an issue.
Okay. As you kind of come to that revelation, the doors kind of, or the entryway, grants a silhouette, and the individual who kind of enters into the space kind of looks to you with a concerned look. This individual is known to you. He was announced in the keep upon entry. He is a member of the retinue of the Abbess. This would be Roderick Ralliard. And as he kind of steps into the space, he looks to Summer and then looks down to the corpses, looks over to the captain, looks over to Summer again, looks to the captain and says, I have been sent to assess your absence from the keep. You have been gone for some time. He's looking at Morax, but he's kind of talking at Mikhail, Casey, and Summer. I can see that you have matters here. And Roman kind of looks to Rallyard. Yes, he's been here the whole time. No one's talked to him. He says, they were found in the gallows, my liege. Rallyard nods. I'll take the report from the captain. Explain what has happened. If you do, you do. Well, if you want to fabricate it, you can.
We were doing our normal patrols, myself and Roman, and found these two hanging from the gallows. Now, I know, obviously, I didn't order it. I didn't know about any of this. And that's about it. Trying to figure out the situation here.
If you were to have instigated it, it's quite a powerful move.
I'm happy to say that, at least to my knowledge, nobody in leadership here has anything to do with this situation.
Ah. Well, obviously, repercussions will amount to this. There's no doubt that they have some form of connection to their masters, perhaps a raven's feather.
Naturally.
And for those who are unaware, Raven's Feather is a token that merchants usually use to give to their loved ones. It's a small charm or bit of magic. The feather is black as long as the person is living. When they die, it turns bright red. It's imbued with the blood of the person and basically allows for someone to know whether or not they are still alive on this mortal plane or not.
I'm going to telepathically say to our group, we'd best, within a day or so, send a message to these folks, just to officially let them know that some of their messengers, something, have been found dead in our town.
You've been quiet for a time. Do you have any thoughts on this? He says, as you are telepathically messaging.
None immediately. Just trying to think over the situation.
Of course. I don't expect for you to have a solution right away.
Fortunately, there ever are.
Has your matriarch been made aware of this?
She has more important things to take care of at the moment.
More than fair. I was assessing whether or not she was keeping this from the Abbess or not. This is important news. Important enough to ruin the matter at hand. This affects not only your town of Gateneath, but also the monastery.
Gotta agree with you. I turn to the others and say, well, shall we go and inform her then? I'd rather do it in person.
Rallyard turns to look to Roman. You are the one who has the lot of this matter and the understanding. I will accept no other besides you to report your conclusions to the Abbess. Roman nods and says, I believe I am barred from entering the keep. Looks to the captain.
Out of character, because I forget. I know that it was because he killed the guy and all that, but...
He shouldn't be in the town. He should be exiled from it entirely, but
gotcha. Yeah.
Evangeline allowed for him to be in the town, but not in the keep. She did not want him in her presence, was the assessment.
Okay. Maybe.
Given the situation, use your better judgment. We
can inquire to the matriarch and ask for her approval on the matter.
Maybe you could. Might I suggest you take the abatis to Romand outside of the keep to meet, and then he could give his report, and then we could go back. Then we could you know, meet the intent of her order.
Rallyard looks to Moirax and just kind of dismissively at Mikhail's statement, and he says, "I expect nothing less of a vintner. You wish for the abbess of Ermorag to exit the safety of the keep, to come and speak to Romand here at a random place?"
Well, the abbess would be well guarded, and it would not be a risk.
So he killed...
Oh, to be fair, the whole town was guarded, and this still happened.
Wait, Summer, you're not helping.
You see, Rallyard...
I'm helping my best.
You see Rallyard's face kind of, like, twist in, like, annoyance, and he says, "So he killed an adulterer. That is why he's being barred from the keep."
I'll speak with the matriarch, and then we can get her up. Approval or disapproval on the situation.
Granted. I will remain here with Romand and await her approval.
Would you like some tea, Gertie? We have plenty.
Romand says, "I would love some." And Rallyard just seems to be kind of serving sourpuss, like just totally annoyed at the whole situation.
I'll be speaking with you soon, and I'll leave to head to the keep.
Running.
The second course is completed by this time, Evangeline, and the music that Dahabe basically interjected to liven the mood has succeeded in that regard. It definitely appears that most feet, despite the music being to the contrary, in-game, it does seem that most folks are kind of coming around and enjoying the hiccups now, the moment. This would be about the time that Moirax would enter. But before that point, is there anything that you want to cover, Evangeline, kind of on the lead up to that? Well, that's really loud.
I don't really think so. Like,
okay. She
knows that something's up, so she's probably a little tense, but is just making small talk to...
Captain of the Guard enters in. You notice that a lot of eyes are present on him as he enters. He makes his way up the dais to your side.
And the abbess is sitting right there next to her.
Yeah, on my right-hand side, I believe.
Yep. Yeah. Her date was Rallyard, so that seat is empty.
Oh, boy. I'll bend down to Evangeline and... Oh, boy. I'll telepathically say...
Bends down, doesn't open mouth.
Just very intensely
you don't even
looking.
Need to like move up to her that far.
Just bend down. Make it look like I'm whispering something, but I'm not